Let's look at the indexing operations which can be done using Python or NumPy. Basically, the indexing operations for one-dimensional arrays are similar to that in Python. So let's create an array using the arrange method. This would essentially create an array with 10 elements. So this is the array which we have created. The box brackets would be used to retrieve an element. So this would retrieve the element with index 0. The indexing starts from 0 and it is up to n minus 1, where n is the total number of elements in the array. Since here we have 10 elements in the array, the indexing would be from 0 to 9, so 9 being the last index. So this is the last index 9. You can also use the negative indices. Minus 1 stands for the last index, minus 2 for the one before that. You can also retrieve the entire array by the colon. This would return the entire array. You can retrieve elements or a subsection of the array by using two numbers separated by a colon. So this would return all elements from index 0 up till index 4. It is to be noted that index 5 is not counted, as in the index after the colon will not be counted, just the index right before that would be counted. So if I do from 1 to 5, again the index 5 would not be counted, it would be 1, 2, 3, 4. I can also just have an integer after the index that would set the the index before the colon to 0. So all the elements from the beginning up till the fourth index would be returned. And also I can have an integer before the colon that would set the end value to be the end of the array. So all the elements from the fifth index up till the last index would be returned. So this is basically how you can do indexing. You can also pass arrays to the array. So if I say 0, 2, 4, so this would return all elements which have with index either 0, 2, and 4. So this is what is returned. So this is basically how you can do indexing with NumPy. It is pretty much similar to what you can do with Python. Let's look at indexing for higher dimensional arrays. So let's create a higher dimensional array. Using the arrange and reshape method, we can create a higher dimensional array. Arrange would essentially give you a one dimensional array, but by using reshape on that, you can get a higher dimensional array. So let's create a 4x4 array. So this is the array we have. So we can use the box brackets again to specify the indices, and we can separate the indices for each of the axes by a comma. So the first index would represent the row number, so this would mean the 0th row, and after the comma, if I say 0, that would mean the 0th column. So this would return the the element from the first row and first column, since that is what index 0 stands for. I can also use the other constructs we had. So I can say, get me all elements from the 0th row. Or this essentially means, get me the elements from the 0th row and all columns. So this is the element from the 0th row and all columns. Or I can say, get me elements from all rows and the 0th column. Or I can say that, get me elements from the 0th row and columns 2 to the end. So this is essentially the 0th row, or the row with index 0 and the last two columns. So you can do stuff like that. You can also pass arrays to this. So I can say 0, 1, comma 0, 1. However, the behavior of this is slightly different from what anybody would have expected. So we would have expected it to create a sort of a smaller 2D array with element 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 2, with element 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, and 1, 1. However, that is not what is done. If you look at this array which is returned, it returns only the element with index 0, 0 and 1, 1. So it sort of does an element-wise grouping. However, if you want the entire square to be returned, you can use the np.x function and pass the arrays you want, comma 1. So this would essentially return the entire section which you were looking for. So this has all the elements 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, and 1, 1. So basically this is how you do indexing with higher dimensional arrays. The concepts which you have seen here can be extended to higher dimensional arrays, like the 3-dimensional or 4-dimensional or n-dimensional arrays, where you can separate the indices by commas and specify one index per axis. Let's look at the logical operations or the conditional operations which we can do. So let's create an array. So this is an array with element with 4 elements. So this is the array which we have created. So if I say a greater than 2, the return value would be a Boolean array with all the elements greater than 2 set to be true and all the others set to be false. So here, since 3 is the only true value, that is set to true, and everything else is set to false. So this is what a Boolean array looks like. It either has true or false values. What I can also do is less than or equal to or not equal to or less than greater or less than equal to or greater than equal to, all that stuff. So I can use all the conditional operators. If I want to chain these, say if I want to say a equal to 2 or a equal to 3, so I will chain the conditions where each condition would be in one of these brackets, and the AND or OR operators would be the logical AND or OR operators. So this is the OR operator, and the other condition would be in a separate bracket. So each of these conditions would be in the bracket separated by the operator. So this is a equal to 2 or a equal to 3. So this is how you say a equal to 2 or a equal to 3. So you can say a equal to 2 and a equal to 3. This is a really unintelligent statement, because never will a be equal to 2 and 3. So everything is going to be false. So this is how you do an AND. Another thing to be noted is that this is not the OR and AND specified by Python. So you cannot use the OR and AND operator of Python. You have to use this pipe or ampersand symbol for OR or AND. So don't try using the OR or AND symbol from Python. It would give an error. Let's talk about the Boolean indexing technique. Here you can pass a Boolean array to any array for the purpose of indexing. So let's create an array. This would create an array of size 4. So this is the array which has been created. So now let's create a Boolean array with b greater than 1. So this is the Boolean array which has been created. Essentially the last two terms have been set to true, where b was greater than 1, and the others have been set to false. So now you can index b using c. this returns all the elements where C was true and does not return the other elements where C was false. You can also index other arrays of size, with one row and four columns. It does not have to be B. You can create another array. So this is A. So you can index A using C. You can also index A using the expression directly. So if I just write B greater than 1, this would essentially produce a Boolean array which is passed as an index. So this would work perfectly fine. The other stuff I can do is I can change the values. This can be done with any indexing technique. Within using it with Boolean indexing is pretty common and pretty powerful. So if I say A of C equal to 100, so all the values in A where C was true would be set to 100. So the last two terms have been set to 100. So this is about Boolean indexing. It is a really powerful technique which you might be using quite often.